Hi, Max. Today is December 8, 2016, and I continue my memories. I was talking about the mobility. So the logic, in brief, is that it looks like we are the dominoes started falling, and we are facing the bumpy ride, bumpy time, hard times. Hopefully, they won't be that bad. Hopefully, it will be just a series of crises and reforms, and we'll see certain parts of the economy fall down, but hopefully it wouldn't be one big crash. Hopefully it would be a series of small crashes. Why the mobility is important? Basically, the transformation of the economy usually goes in pockets. Some pockets, some cities, some areas fall apart and some areas prosper. For example, a large number of people are now involved in the areas of the economy which might become useless, especially at the time of the crisis. And some other people are servicing this category of people. So there are lots of people in marketing, sales, and financial planning. Most likely those jobs will shrink a lot. So there will be a lot of unemployed people whose main talents is to talk and to sell stuff. And there will be much more need for production because if the economy becomes more flat, what do you mean flat? It's like all countries become equal. If that happens, then many things would have to be produced locally. So lots of people, there will be many more jobs in production and many fewer jobs in planning and sales and finances and less computer, less office work, more production. That's kind of obvious prediction if you think about it. Until now, many productions were outsourced outside of the country. But if the global economy will start to shake, then things would have to be produced locally. So then the mobility is important not only in terms of place, but also in terms of just finding where are you needed, where your talents are needed. Basically looking for jobs and learning new stuff. My Russian experience is very relevant in many ways because Russia went through such a crisis about 30 years ago in late 80s, early 90s, around 1990. Great many people lost their jobs and most of the people lost their savings. Most of the people lost their social security and their pensions. The retirement savings became nothing. Retirement pensions became so small that they won't be useful anymore. But what is one of the biggest lessons was that people died mostly not from hunger. People died mostly from disconnection from the future, from the disconnection from the energies, disconnection from the society. Losing themselves, they basically realize that what they want is not there anymore, what they like is not there anymore, so they just couldn't find themselves in the new world. That's the simple thing. So those who could rediscover themselves, they lived long. Yeah, people the hunger in 90s wasn't as strong as the hunger, say, in 30s and in 20s. So it wasn't the hunger, it was ability of the person to adapt and to rediscover themselves and make themselves useful and connected to the energies. In Russia I was very much connected. I was part of a small layer of society which was basically dissidents. Some of them were open dissidents, and many of us were not open. We were talking to each other, but we didn't come open much. And at that time, there was no internet. So basically, coming open means we didn't go on the streets and demonstrate frequently. In the Soviet times, some people went on the streets, but usually it was so heavily prosecuted, it was suicidal to go on the streets, because they would, the system would take you on into the you will get on the blacklist, and then you wouldn't be able to find jobs and so on. So dissidents, right? You know the word dissidents, meaning the opposition, yeah, the intellectual opposition, the political opposition. Free thinkers, right? Intelligentsia. Blacklists, yeah, you know about blacklists. Basically, yeah, because there was so few people in Soviet Union, and the totalitarian system was so few who went against the system openly, the lists was easy to maintain. It wasn't millions, it was more like hundreds of people. So as soon as you get into that list, then you got in trouble. Those people, usually they survived just because the relatives would support them. They couldn't find their own job, so they would have relatives to support them, or some of them, I forgot the expression, but basically they worked doing the work for someone else. Like writers would write plots, would write scenarios for the movies, scripts for the movies, but then somebody else would publish them. And that was kind of allowed, you know, it is worldwide. If you're in a blacklist, that's what you do. If you're a writer or a creative artist, you would work for someone else who would provide you with the work and put their name for you on that work. So the final transformation was that there was much of energy in that activity of being a free thinker, being in the opposition. Basically, you saw the purpose in your life and you saw absolute necessity in what you do. So many poets, songwriters, writers, creative artists, movie makers were really inspired by the need and the importance of the work they did. The creative poetry, oppositional poetry, basically, oppositional writings were copied by people unofficially, and that was a huge part of our culture, a huge part of our transformation. And then in late 90s, I would say about 94, 95, the system basically was completely destroyed, and the censorship wasn't there anymore. Even in 94, I guess it was completely gone. 93, 94, the censorship was completely gone. So that was the period when many of our leaders, our writers, our spiritual leaders, just lost their ground, lost their energy. Because if everything is allowed, if everything is public, if there is no censorship, if there is no prohibition, if all the pressure is released, then, and if it is basically the democracy, if people do what they want, then there is no energy there. There is not much. Your voice is not heard anymore. That's basically it. Yeah. So many poets, oppositional poets, just stopped writing. Many writers just had nothing to say because their word didn't matter anymore. You know, everybody's word would be equal. You know, anybody can say anything, and it was just general disappointment. And the general disappointment was not because things went well, but because things went low vibration, basically. Yeah. Whole country, many people would start speaking, and they would speak low vibrational things. So until the opening of the censorship, until the fall of the system, the alternative word, the oppositional word mattered. And when there is nothing to oppose to, then everybody becomes opposition. There is no unity. There was complete disarray, complete chaos, complete randomness. And in this randomness, any common sense just drowns. You can see that in the West. Yeah, like if you have a wonderful idea, you post it on Facebook, you post it on other social network, you speak it up, and nothing happens. Just noise, noise, noise. You are drowned in commercials. So Russia just faced that in about 92, 94. And there was no leadership, spiritual leadership anymore, because, you know, everyone is spiritual leader, everyone is speaking, and there is just random noise. And then Putin came to power, and the power became stronger, and censorship became stronger, and the same people who were silent for 10 years, maybe even 15 years, just found another voice. So they have the inspiration, they have something to say, and people heard them, because again it was unity in the wrong direction, right? It was country united around a relatively negative leader, and then the opposition became sparse. And if you're in a position, your voice is heard again, and if you have something too smart to say, people would really listen. So that's a paradox, I guess. There were so many words, but it's hard to describe it shorter. But basically, when there is negative unity, standing against it makes sense and you're heard. But if there is a disarray, it's really hard to stand against the disarray, or at least unity. Again, the light drowns when there is so much of noise, right? So if there is noise, it drowns. But if there is darkness, then your light is visible. So I guess this might relate to this reality again. If we see some negative events happening, then again, maybe you will be heard. Especially when the time comes and the humanity realizes that the aliens are here, nearby, and they're offering help, that they're real, then your voice will most likely be heard. At least there will be some moment of silence, some period of silence, when your voice becomes valuable, as you have experienced, as you experience the contact, as you experienced thinking about the contact, as you experienced talking to the higher dimensional beings. All of that experience is would be very relevant. It is now relevant, but if there is a global awakening, then your experience would be really valuable. Let me jump now to the year, I think it was 93. Actually, there was two events which kind of overlap in my memory. I think one of them was in 93 and another one was around 91. I think it was pretty much the same thing. I needed to focus on certain project. First project was writing a patent for my invention. So in these hard times, I kind of still worked on certain invention and with my co-workers, and this invention helped me to get into the United States. And I had two small children at home and a wife, and it's just hard to focus in a small tiny apartment with noise and stuff. It's just hard to focus on science. Same thing in the lab. It's another story, but my lab was full of friends and people would party all the time, and they would just live there. Can you imagine? Yeah, scientific laboratory and people just live there, right? But that's, you know, how we lived. It makes a lot of sense. If you are not paid for work, and if your work can be done at night, why not to sleep in the lab? You know, lots of people slept at their work and saved money on renting. it made a lot of sense. So my friend had a summer house, a small party, like a small half of the summer house. No, not a small half, half of a small summer house. And to get there, you just sit on the electric train, and it's about maybe an hour or less than an hour travel. You know, and Moscow is a big city, so just to get to the train station, it takes an hour, and then another maybe less than an hour on a train. And then you walk for about 15 minutes, and you get to the summer house. But the time when I needed to do the work was the winter, and it was really cold, right? And everybody is depressed, and the economy is crazy, but still the trains come more or less on schedule, plus minus half an hour, right? And again, got a little bit of money at that time. Yeah, I got enough money to function. So, and the winter was cold. So I get my papers, you know, no computers at that time yet, no portable computers at that time. So I get the printouts, I get all the information I need, and English wasn't strong, so it was in English printouts and a dictionary, right? It's hard to imagine, like, yeah, you're Russian with poor, very, very, very poor English, and then you try to write up your invention and figure out if it is new, like, so basically the reference papers and stuff, the patents. And I get in this summer house, and it is cold, right? But, you know, that's the only place you can, like, really get by yourself. And the nights alone and the days in the winter are very short. Just, you know, the sun barely gets above horizon, and the day is very short. So I come there, and it just too cold, but the summer house had a gas stove, so there was a gas pipe, so you can use gas for cooking. There was no gas heater; it was a summer house, just a little stove and a pipe. So there was some heat there, and there was also electricity, so you can run an electric heater. So had one half a kilowatt electric heater, basically an average small heater, and this stove, and that was about it. Right, and but it was quiet. You're like alone in a little village of summer houses, so not many people live there. I don't think I met anyone there for the about I was there for all under 2 weeks, maybe 2 weeks, almost 2 weeks. It was wonderful. It was, can you imagine being by yourself in the nature in the winter for 2 weeks? It was amazing, and really, really focused. Yeah, I was, you know, this was being focused, so you use intuition, and you focus on certain things, and you get things done. So, what do you do if it is cold, and the water freezes, and you're inside the house, it freezes, it's below 0 Celsius, right, below 0 Celsius, so water, below the freezing point. So I had skis, cross-country skis. You know, in Russia, cross-country skis are very popular because there was not that many mountains, but cross-country skiing is what people do. It's healthy, and it is also a way to get somewhere, right? You just cross-country ski. So I got to the skis, got to the station, took the train, and the train asked if they know any stores. People didn't know the stores, but you know, as you go on the train, you see certain kind of shopping centers around. So I saw some distant shopping, sort of kind of shopping center, some kind of a little town, and I went there, and there was a hardware store, and I had an idea that I need to insulate the walls, so and the windows. I got a big roll of polyethylene, and nails. It's called furniture nails, but nails, tons of nails, small ones, and I came back, and I just insulated all the windows, all the doors in the kitchen, so the air wouldn't go through the holes, yeah, through the slits. And then if you turn on the heater and turn on your gas stove, you can sit on a ladder. There was a ladder there, so you can sit on the ladder there, under the ceiling, and it was like very, very hot on the top, relatively hot. And then there was kind of intermediate, and in the bottom was really cold. So if you turn all the heat on and you just kind of regulate where you sit on this ladder, like big wooden staircase, yeah, small wooden staircase, then you would get into the area where you're relatively comfortable. Ideally, you need to be upside down. You need the head in the cold and the legs in the warm, but, you know, that was sufficient to survive. It was sufficient. So just that idea of kind of insulating the windows I was proud of it, and it was practical. It worked really well. And I survived the cold weather, and when I was tired and depressed and tired, I would get on the skis and I would ski, and there was full moon, and the moon was so bright that I could ski at night under that moon. That memory of skiing under the moon at night, obviously there was, the trail, so, you know, you could see the trail. You don't really have to, like, go through the raw snow. You have to go just on, like, it was, or there was already a trail, so it was easy to ski. You kind of just roll across along the, tracks. You just slide across the tracks. So that was wonderful, and I had a bit of alcohol in Russia. You know, you believe that alcohol is good for you, right? It's hard for you to believe, but just a bit, not much, just to regulate your sleep pattern. So if you want to sleep, you get a little bit of alcohol, you kind of relax, and not much. It was just a tiny bit. And I drank tea and ate pasta. I bought some pasta. You cook pasta and I think maybe carrots. Pasta, carrots, and vegetable oil. That was my diet. And I lived for a couple of weeks. It was wonderful and great. So I figured out the patent. I came back. I rode back to my American, let's call it partners, although it was more like counterparts, and it kind of worked. So in 93, about half a year later, I went to America in the summer. So half a year later in the summer, I went to America, and it was my first experience of America. It was a cultural shock. I wasn't very healthy. I was sick in many ways, but it was great. I loved it. I loved some of that, not everything. And it took many years to adapt, many years. I still, you know, it takes, it's culturally, it's so different. So, but that's a different story. I had an experience of being a street musician and a beggar, maybe for a few minutes. Maybe it was just for fun. It was a prank more than a real thing, but it sort of worked. So I experienced that. And in my mind, I come back to this experience some once in a while. So it was a year, I think 1985, 31 years ago, and I was young. I was 21. Yeah, I was 21, and my friends were with me, and we traveled in the spring. We traveled just for hiking into a Russian city. I think it was Volokolamsk. It was a wonderful weekend morning, and people were just had a nice weekend mood, and some people went to church and some people went elsewhere, but there was a weekend mood. And I went first. I think I took a bus, and my friends were hiking behind, so I had lots of backpacks, so I had to wait for them for quite a while. So as I was waiting, I had a guitar with me, but also I had a recorder. So I was sitting in the middle of a big square with people, like sunny square, Some people were walking around. And I pulled out a recorder. And I had a recorder musical instrument with me. It's called a recorder. It's like a flute. I just sat there and I started playing. And I had a hat on me. And I was thinking, when my friends come, they would say, why wouldn't you put your hat in front of you? It was kind of obvious. If you play on the square in a holiday, then you should put a hat. So I was thinking, you know, I don't want to be redundant. I don't want to be trivial. How about I just put it in front of me? It would look prettier. And as soon as I put my hat in front of me, people started placing money there. And I closed my eyes, and my main effort was not to laugh, because for me it was a joke. But I had experience first begging, and second collecting money, and you know, playing, being a street musician, all together in one experience. Soon I stopped, because I thought that maybe what I meant wasn't what they meant. But for them, I think it was just normal. Finally, I counted the money. It wasn't too much, but it was many people put the money there. Very little, like little change, but it was wonderful. So I had this experience, and this experience being a street musician is dear to me. And since then, in the time of desperation, I'm coming back to the idea of becoming a street musician again, because there is so much beauty in it. You just play and people pay, and you don't have a boss, you don't have to plan, you just play when you can. And when I meet street musicians, I always kind of talk to them and ask them about hanging around with them, and ask about their life and ask about the ways they do the things. I have a friend who is from the same kind of background as I, from Russia, a Jew from Russia, and he's a professional street musician. He does it for a living, and he does it for many, many years in New York City, which is different. So basically, one take-home lesson from all that experience is that to be really a professional street musician, you have to be in a proper place, like New Orleans, possibly Chicago, but not as much. But New Orleans and New York City would be very conducive to that idea. And now I met a new friend just a few days ago, maybe 6 days ago, just once. And she is a professional musician, a musician and a singer. And she speaks Russian and sings in English and Spanish and Russian. So we are contemplating playing somewhere together. That would be fun. So about practical aspects of being a street musician. In America right now, you have to get a license. And different cities, different towns have different ways of doing that. But basically, you either are protected by the police, so you have to get a license, or you have to deal with criminals, either way. So when you know, they can take your guitar, they can take your money, and so on. So that is a factor. So having a band which is kind of strong physically and strong mentally, spiritual, how do you say, you know, have that sturdity, that sense of strength, so is important. Or you have to be charming, either way. I guess playing during the day in safe places is fine. It really depends on where you are. But as you are on the streets, as you become visible, basically you become, if people remember you, then you have to deal with that fact. As you just walk by, it's one thing, but when you're a street musician, you would become part of the street, and some streets are not as safe as others. It has a lot of things to do with karma. So some people just are fully protected, so they can be easily on the street, and their nature is such that nobody would harm them. And some people attract trouble. You know, I know just a couple outliers. Outliers is a scientific term meaning out of the order. Usually there is a crowd of dots on the graph, and then there is two dots way out of the crowd, and these are called outliers. So I know a couple of outlier people, who actually three of them, and there is something in common among them, but they attract a lot of trouble, and they're so used to that. There are many names for them. It's not troublemakers, it's more like trouble attractors. It's not even losers, because they kind of used to that, and they just live successfully with that that ability to attract trouble. But it just happens to them all the time. And whatever happens to them is, like other people, it would be the biggest trauma in their life, but they just live with it normally. Like the worst, like, you know, there are many stories, but one story, you know, imagine my friend Sasha in Moscow. He actually became a politician at a certain point. I think he's still a politician. But at a certain point, he was digging something, and he somehow struck, and he was absolutely, he already knew he's unlucky. He struck the cable with, I guess, with shovel or something like a shovel. Maybe it was automatic machine. And it was 5,000 volts, so he was hurt a lot. He went to the hospital. But, you know, those people, they have that capacity to recover very fast.
Sabat?
Yeah, he's fine. It was a trauma, but I don't think he noticed it. Another friend, yeah, that was a big trauma, really. Another friend, his story is very educational. He was in Italy, and he left his passport and, you know, whole thing with the documents in the car, and the car, you know, the robbers just, you know, broke in the car and stole his everything, including his passport. And his passport, I think it was maybe an Israeli passport with American visa, or a Russian passport with American visa. So the visa, basically, he lost the visa. So he had to recover the passport. And when he went to an American embassy, they refused him a visa. Just didn't give him the visa. You know, they do that stuff all the time. And he didn't see his family, a wife with small children, for 8 years. A wife visited him in Europe, but he couldn't move to America. So for 8 years, she was by herself with the children. And then finally he got visa, and he became a professional, how do you call it? A professional immigration lawyer. So don't leave your documents in a car in Italy. So I met one street musician, I gave him a ride. He was like a really like homeless street musician. He was okay for a homeless, he didn't smell too much, but he had that mentality of a homeless, and his mind didn't stay on the same topic for a while. He couldn't think straight. He wasn't on drugs, he just couldn't think straight. But he had a guitar and he traveled. And I asked him how he finds a place to play. And he says, yes, it is a trouble, because if you play somewhere where police can catch you, then you're in trouble, right? So he goes to private places, like food stores, like groceries, big grocery stores. And he would sit in front of the grocery store and play. And people who go to grocery store actually, they spend money there, so if you spend like $100 in a store, you might drop a dollar for a musician. But then the management would come out, and sometimes they let him stay, or sometimes they tell him to go. So that's unhappy life of a traveling homeless street musician. So I'm discussing that again with the idea that, in I guess, in Russia, it became big, it became big because people love that, especially when it's the whole thing shakes, when there is a lot of fear, when there is a lot of madness. Yeah, basically the big change, the main trouble in a big change, big transformation, is you have to stay sane and you have to stay to fight your depression, right? How do you fight your depression? And that is where street musicians are invaluable. The music in general and live music is magic. So street musicians are like magicians which help you to reconnect. In Russia, I don't remember the time, but I think it was gradually from 89 to 92, lots of people lost jobs. Like, it's not numbers, it's more like, I would say percent-wise, it would be gradually from a few percent people losing jobs to a few percent people keeping jobs. Yeah, something like that. From, say, initially there was like 3% unemployment in Russia to about, hard to say, maybe 50%, maybe 70%, maybe 90%. It's really hard to calculate because formerly lots of people would have the jobs, but they wouldn't go to work, and they wouldn't work, and they wouldn't be paid. So do you have a job or not? why would it be possible? Because it was a system that is falling apart. And some parts of the system still are working, and you know, it's still, there is a hope that things will come back. So people would come to their job once in a while and just to socialize. I mean, many places would still kind of barely function, but still function. I was lucky. I was in a science where the schedule was free and it was okay. Basically, if you're in good relationship with your lab director, how do you call it, to your scientific chef or chief, scientific chief, then you would just speak to them and explain, and they would forgive you. So basically, because you're not paid, so it's more like lots of volunteers doing some fun work. It's like a club. Same with police. Like, you know, even police, their salaries became so minimal that they went to become criminals, basically. They went to collect the money from the people, so they would typically take a passport from you and then return it only for the money, right? They wouldn't do it to everybody, but they would do it to foreigners, to people outside of the city. So each city would have their own people, and you know, if they're your visitor or your trader, then you look different, and the police would catch you and then try to extract money from you. Sounds fun, right? So many office workers would lose their jobs. One of my family circle people, they were very established, but at a certain point they were part of the kind of administration, government administration, but somehow they didn't stay there. I guess they were also bored, and I don't know yet. I don't know why, but by some reason they just moved away, and they started a business of growing flowers. They just would grow a lot of flowers on their small garden, bring it to the market and sell it on the market. And that was, I guess it was seasonal, but that's what they did with pleasure. And one day they just needed physical help, so they asked me to help. So I kind of helped them. So I was aware of that, more aware. So my first business was very small. It was a student business, and it was just one day of exercise. But I guess it had certain formula for the business, and it could have worked if I wanted to, but I just, for me, it wasn't good enough because there was, I discovered there was sort of deception in it, and then I canceled. But initially the idea was pretty. It was 1986, exactly 30 years ago, and there was a Chernobyl disaster. I graduated from Moscow University Chemical Department. I had training with radiation chemistry. I knew the dangers more or less, not very much. I mean, it was a secret how dangerous it was. At that time, it was a secret. And actually, one of my friends went to Chernobyl to work, and he came back, and he survived, basically. Although he had a lot of exposure, for him it was a big service. He was a good guy, although he had, you know, he went, often he went, he got into trouble. He also was drinking, and he liked to fight, so police would catch him. So, and he was not a very good student, but he was still a good guy. So, and because he didn't have good grades, he was sent to a radiation department, which kind of was a bit more dangerous and not as popular. So his expertise was in radiation. And when the Chernobyl disaster happened, he helped to clean up. And he was proud of it, and he survived somehow, which wasn't frequent. So as I understand, the Chernobyl was more like a nuclear reaction which went out of control. So there was more or less like it's a slow going nuclear bomb going. Somewhere in Chernobyl, I guess it's Ukraine, Belarus, somewhere there, in the west of Russia. And the government, stupid Soviet government of 1986, kept it secret as much as possible. They wouldn't tell anyone. And I think they kept it so much secret they didn't know themselves much what is going on. But the main danger was the cloud of, you know, for outside of that area, the main danger was the cloud of radioactive dust traveling and where that dust would sediment. So nobody knew where it would go. And at that time, the internet didn't exist, at least in Russia, it didn't exist. 86, I don't think it was there. I think it first gopher was 88, 89. So it was just 3 years before, 3 years before the internet would actually start becoming more connected and formalized. It was even before HTML, right? So we didn't know, and the only information we got was on the window pane of a certain grocery store. There was some sort of a map which showed some sort of where did the radiation go. But again, we didn't know how true it was. Maybe it was all propaganda. So it was a spring of, I guess, yeah, what was the spring? I think it was 86. And I had an access to a Geiger counter, which was very rare. I just worked in the lab where we used a portable Geiger counter. And no, I think it was 87. It was after Chernobyl. It was the spring after Chernobyl, 1987. So it was around end of April where people would go and start working in their summer homes and gardens. And for people, it would be very useful to know whether their gardens were polluted with radiation, right? So I was, you know, the idea was, how about we go from one garden to another and offer them to measure their pollution, radioactive pollution in Moscow suburbs. I offered that idea to my friend, and he agreed. He was also kind of, his name was Max, is Max, and he's certainly of the same entrepreneurial nature. Guess what his profession is now? He is a newspaper journalist, a reporter, an independent reporter, and analytic. So two graduates, we grabbed our Geiger counter and went from one summer house to another offering our help. And the response was great. So the market I was identified perfectly. My marketing sense was perfect. So people were really interested to find out if their soil was contaminated. And what was even better from scientific point of view, we had a perfect demonstration that we can measure, our device is sensitive enough to measure the signal, which is rare as well. Because we found that, you know, first houses, we like first garden plots we measured carefully, we found that the places, fireplaces, where are the leftovers of burned organic wood, they count more. There is, I think it is a natural phenomenon, I still need to Google why, but there should be some isotope, maybe it's, I don't even know which of the isotopes it is. Unlikely it's carbon, it's something else. There is some enrichment in certain isotopes, so burned wood is always counts about maybe, I would say, 8 times more than background. And we could measure it and show to the customers that our device can measure, can detect the radiation. But as we went from one house to another, I think we went maybe to, we measured maybe about 15 houses, and our success rate was about maybe every second house would agree to get our service. It was wonderful. From the marketing point of view and from a sales point of view. And our price was very fair. We basically accepted donations and we accepted, and our price was very, very affordable. Maybe like equivalent of maybe $8 per house. So the result was that we didn't find any contamination. I guess it was washed out with the rain or something, or maybe there was the radiation didn't reach Moscow. So as I was honest and I wasn't desperate, I decided that it's not fair to go from one house to another charging money when we know that there is no contamination. So we canceled it, but that was a decent formula for the business. So how to formulate the principle. Basically, there is a change, you analyze it, see what new demands are coming out of this change, and try to meet these demands, and then you explore it safely without going into much investment, because it's risky to invest. So you don't invest until you're really sure. So you do your first pilot sales and see how the market responds, and then you might expand on that. At that point, I didn't expand because I was desperate and I had better things to do than trick people to pay money. In terms of experience, I was young and inexperienced, of course. I had always the spirit, the personality qualities of an explorer. I always wanted to go and do something new and that should be useful for people and teach people something new. And the strategy I developed, I guess I developed it by picking mushrooms. Yeah, that was, at least that's how I see it. In Russia, there is that art of picking mushrooms. It's a collective entertainment. You travel to the forest, and usually do it in the fall, because mushrooms grow in the fall, in the September. September is best time for mushroom picking. You have to pick certain types. In America, mushrooms are known to be like poisonous, and it's not just a myth. It is real. Like many more mushrooms are poisonous in the United States, and in Europe, in Russia, it's Western Russia. And Europe and Western Russia, it is, there is, they're just edible. You know certain types, and they're edible and tasty and actually good for you. So I grew up in that culture. My grandparents, my parents, we all always liked to do that. It's kind of also very spiritual exercise. You go, you communicate with the forest, and you search for something, you find it, and it makes you happy. I guess why it makes you happy, just because it's something cultural. You've been prized for collecting best beautiful mushrooms and collecting more of them. So to do that, I discovered if you walk fast and look for certain traits, you develop a certain pattern of the search, and in certain places of the forest, a certain pattern of plants and light and humidity, you are more likely to find mushrooms, good mushrooms. Usually that would be on the border between the forest and the field. I would say a few meters into the forest, and you need certain type of trees and a certain type of grass and vegetation and the soil, and that's where you find it. And it has to be sufficiently, and humidity is very important. All right, so you walk fast and look for these traits. As soon as you find a suitable area, you start walking in circles and kind of cover the area. And if you find one mushroom, usually they go in groups. So you start searching much more carefully and search around until you kind of find out if it was a single outlier, single mushroom, or there was a group there. And then if not, then you keep running fast. And I was a very good walker at that time. So I would walk fast and find and calibrate my parameters, criteria, so I would find best mushroom family, and then you would collect a lot of beautiful mushrooms. And then as you do that, you usually get lost in the forest. Near Moscow, it is relatively safe to get lost, because there are roads, so if you just go in one direction, you finally would hit either a river or a road, and then you would follow a river and a road, and you will find some people, and people will tell you where to go, more or less, sometimes. And so it's not that dangerous. Basically, there are intersections, so to find a big forest where you can get really lost, you have to really go far from Moscow. And it was in my days, 30 years ago. Now it's much more populated in suburbs, so it's even less possible to get lost there, to be lost there. But basically, it is practice to basically navigate, use the sun, and also you kind of, you know, if you go down, you go to the river, right? Do you know that rule? If you always like try to go where it's like downhill, finally you get to some water, at least in that area, or at least you get in California area, you would get to you'll get to the canyon, and if you follow the canyon, you might get to the ocean, right? So the same principle is in the business, right? You search for certain patterns, and then you look for certain criteria, and when you find this criteria, you explore it a little bit. You do the pilot studies, pilot experiments, pilot sales, speak to people, and you try to identify the need, which is yet uncovered, and then you try to identify the dangers. And in Russia, the main dangers are criminals, basically. If you start doing certain business and getting money, criminals would soon discover you and tax you pretty badly. And the danger would be also of being robbed, and physically abused and killed, right? So you need some sort of protection or some sort of invincibility or some sort of invisibility. Invincibility and invisibility would be best. That is why best businesses in such criminal countries as Russia are the ones which don't require location, don't require properties, so people wouldn't be able to find you. You would be invisible, you would be movable, and you would do business somehow remotely, so you wouldn't actually physically be present there, like internet businesses and things of that sort. So movable businesses are of great value in Russia, and localized businesses attached to the ground, attached to the property, usually are in trouble. They would develop a little bit and then they would be either taxed or bought from you, or they would change the owner or else, or they would be closed. So very few businesses would flourish which are attached to the location, unless of course they are covered by local police or local criminal system. Like, they have to be incorporated in the system. You cannot come from outside of the system and start a business. You have to somehow to find a niche in the system to be covered and to be to know where to pay your taxes, basically legal and illegal taxes. That's in Russia. In America, in the Western world, it would be different in many ways right now. It's not about illegal taxes. It is more about how do you get the customers, right? You identify the niche, but then I was in that shoes many times. So you know that you can produce certain service or the product. You know the customers need it, but the people here are so overwhelmed with advertisement that they don't trust anyone. And there is no way to reach your customers because they just are overwhelmed. There is no way to reach them. They are in their world, and just how do you tell them that there is what they need? How do you offer them? Nowadays there are few trading places which kind of actually grow. Like, one of them is Amazon. So if you can produce a product which is sellable on Amazon, just placing it on Amazon could be sufficient. Another place is Etsy, which is ETSY. It is a place for selling homemade products like incense, supplements and stuff of that sort. Essential oils, that's Etsy.com. And eBay is okay, it's like, eBay might be okay. I don't have a good experience selling things on eBay, but it is okay. And for selling services, there is like, best one is guru.com. It is for writers and other qualified workers, basically for freelance workers to provide their services. That system works pretty well, but you have to kind of learn how to use it and be consistent. You have to be there. You have to be plugged in the system and really respond fast to the request of the customer. So customers post their, it's called jobs, post their offers of certain work to be done, and you have to know how to offer them what they need and do it in really fast, because other would, if they have more experience, they would win that job. And then that's usually hourly, weekly, short time, short period job. Like, I used it for text editing. I needed certain text to be edited in English, and it gave me a wonderful price, and it was very convenient. And the people on the other side did wonderful work doing the work and offering the work. So there is a real market there for freelance work, guru.com. I think there is also a site, I think it's called Freelancer. I didn't find it as useful, but I think it's a similar thing. And for services, I used, for Reiki services in America, I used Groupon, and I think it was called Go Social. And it helped me to start the business, and people were coming, so it was psychologically wonderful. So the whole cycle started to roll, and this whole wheel started to roll. But it wasn't very profitable, but it was barely paying for my effort. But at least it allows you to reach certain customers. So consider that with positive and negative sides of that. There is a lot of discussion about that on the internet, so you would be able to research and find if it's suitable for you. But reaching others is difficult in this state of economy. Let me, I guess that would be next logical step. I would tell you about what happened in Russia in hard times. So in Russia, reaching the customers was through writing the ads by hand and posting them on public places. I guess it was my most successful business, and it was most successful in hard times. Basically, that allowed my family to actually to eat. In the most hungry times, I think it was around 91, 92, there was nothing to eat. I had two children, and I was desperate. My science job didn't pay. There was no jobs around. And what happened was, I noticed that many telephone apparatuses started to break, because the whole system was breaking, but people still need telephones, and cell phones didn't come yet. They would come maybe 6 years later, now around 96, 97, 98, 99. That's where cell phones came. At that time, it was still the old wired phones, and the new ones weren't there yet. The market didn't open yet. The free market, the Chinese phones, the foreign phones didn't come, and the Russian-made phones, I guess the factory maybe broke, or by some reason in Russia it was always, it's called deficit, lack of things, lack of simple things. So there was no phones. People had phone lines, but no phone apparatuses. The stores were empty, the whole economy fell apart, and they needed people to fix them. So I would always fix my phones at home, at work. At home, I always would have phones in every room, all connected in parallel. Kind of obvious, right? And usually even in the bathroom. Yep. And it was just fun. And my grandfather taught me that. My grandfather taught me how to solder. And as a child, I always had his electronic things to play, so it was kind of native to me. When I was like 2 or 3 years old, that's what I did. I played with his transistors, resistors, and other electronic parts in his kind of desk, electronic desk. So I did it many times in my life, many times, to make advertising, to make homemade ads and post them on the wall. It was fun. And at that time, I just write them by hand, give my phone number, which is fun, like how people would call you if the apparatus has broken. But in any way, that's what you do. You give them phone number, and it was obviously a home phone number, right? And so you have to have a secretary on the number, and my wife or me. And you say, I'm fixing your phones. I would come to you and fix it. That's simple. A piece of paper, and it would have like a little strips of paper with a phone number, and maybe I would say, fixing phones, something like on that little strip. So tear off strip, so you would stick this half a page size ad on the wall, and people would take the strips out. And there was no post boards, but every door of every apartment building, like every front door of the apartment building, would have tons of ads on it. So I would grab either homemade glue or later, like we would buy commercial glue, but mostly it was homemade glue. Homemade glue. How do you make homemade glue? You buy, you take either cornstarch is best, or just flour, wheat flour, and just boil it, make a glue. Just boil it with water. And you will take your brush, a jar with the glue, and see, like you make this homemade ads, cut them with scissors to get the strips, and you would go around and post this on every place you think is appropriate. And that is actually fun because it's the beginning of enterprise. When it becomes like better going, then I would take my my wife and I would take my children. So they would, I don't think they were, the children at that time were pretty small. Maybe take my bigger child and we'll go together and do it. And then people would start calling me, and you would go to their places, to their homes, with your soldering iron and a little set of tools, and fix stuff. And really, I wouldn't be able to fix it, which is kind of a shame, but usually it's kind of a simple, just wire broke, and you would find it with a disconnection and solder it. And it paid wonderfully, so I would go fix the thing and would come back with food. The food was already, at that time, the food was already available. I guess it was imported food, but it was already available if you had the money. Before that, it's just hard to explain, but before that it was only food stamps and standardized Soviet food. So for the money you couldn't buy much food. I mean, the food for the money was too expensive, so the only way to buy less expensive food was to stand in line, and there was huge waiting lines. So instead of regulation by price and by money, it was government controlled prices, so government controlled low prices and limited supply, and you would have to stay in line. And that's, I would say, the typical state of the crisis. Typical state of the crisis when there is government-controlled prices, yes. And I guess you have to keep in mind, it wasn't me, it wasn't me knowing much, not having much experience. It was me just learning. It was 1992. I was 26. I was married only for a few years. My wife was very young. I think she was like, she was 22, and we had the first one child was 2.5 years, another child was 1/2 year old. And it was a lot of desperation, but also there was a lot of bravery, young bravery. We were brave. We weren't afraid. We were just, I guess, inventive. We were inventive. There is, I was sick much of the time, but there was still some idea that it's okay, we'll move forward. I guess there was the idea of tons of opportunities. We knew, at the same time as our doors were closed, lots of doors were open, yes. And it was obvious. There was that, as I mentioned, there was the understanding there was a bigger world outside. There was America, there was Israel, there was Europe. There was a bigger world, and as the doors were closing in Russia, the doors to the bigger world were opening, and we saw how this bigger world was coming. So It's very much like we have now. As the Earth, many things on Earth are closing. We see how the alien doors are opening. Yes, it is, you know. The Earth, the old Earth is ending, but the galactic Earth is starting. Right, so that was the same feeling. We weren't desperate. We felt guidance. We felt that some people already gave us wisdom. So we did a lot of research and we relied on our trusted gurus, I guess. We had not many, but there were a few trusted gurus who guided us. It wasn't even the practical knowledge. It was more like spiritual discovery, the discovery of spiritual value. It was rediscovery of religion. Yes, religion was also coming back. Rediscovery of God, rediscovery of spirit, yes. It was more like through poetry and songs and theater, but it was in the air. We were part of that rediscovery. All right, I will talk to you later, and thank you for listening. I still invite your comments, invite helpers to help with the webinars and to help with, to take charge of the conversion of our recorded videos to the internet radio and podcasts, basically to audio format, which is accessible for the smartphones. And send the donations to max@humancon.org with the comment that it is for Jim's monitor. Thank you for all your support, for all your comments, all your comments, all your energy you're sending us. Have a good day.